We're here on site near Milton Keynes with MJ Electrical to shoot a series of videos on this beautiful property. In this one, we're going to discuss the five things that you should know about installing fire alarms as we see the installation of these smoke and heat alarms from Fire Angel. The last time we were on site with MJ Electrical, we were installing a Tesla charger, and we had a little chat with the owner of the business, Matt, about some of the challenges in running an electrical business. But as electricians, we all know that we wear many hats and we need many strings to our bow. So what should we be thinking about when we're installing smoke alarms? Number one, assess the risk. Before installation, you need to design the fire alarm system. And before you design it, you need to carry out a risk assessment. Why does this matter? Well, because every property is different in terms of design, use, and occupier. An installation in a property with a high risk of fire, occupied by less physically able individuals, needs to respond to a fire much more quickly than one that's occupied by a physically able person. There's a number of things to consider for a fire alarm risk assessment, and it should be carried out on a room-by-room basis. After all, the likelihood of a fire breaking out here is much lower than the risk of a fire breaking out here. You'll want to consider the likelihood of various things happening, including a fire breaking out, the results of this in terms of injury or death, how effective the detection and warning will be in the space, the characteristics of the occupant, and any potential ignition sources in the room. All of this should be recorded not only as evidence that it's been done, but also so that it can be consulted in the future should any alterations be made or required. For further detailed information on the process of this risk assessment, we heartily recommend getting a copy of this book, The Practical Guide to Grade D Fire Alarm Systems. It contains detailed information on how to do risk assessment right. Number two, understand your grades. That leads us nicely on to considering just what a Grade D fire alarm system is. Now, there's some potential for confusion here because there's both a grade of fire alarm system and a category, and they use similar codes. First of all, there's the grade of system, which is the type of fire alarm equipment installed. So you'll have noticed yourself that the fire alarm installation that you'd find in a large commercial property like a hotel or a college has a central control panel and an image of the zones next to it. And that's very different to the interlinked Fire Angel heat and smoke alarms that we have in this property. That's because they are different grades of fire alarm. These used to run alphabetically from A to F with various distinguishing features, with D to F being mainly used in domestic settings like this one. In the 2020 update to BS 5839-6, grades B and E are no longer defined. Grade E, because they were powered by the mains with no battery backup, which is not a great system, and had pretty much been stopped being made by manufacturers. This smoke detector from Fire Angel complies with grade D, which basically means they run off mains power, but also have a battery backup for if the mains should fail. But you'll notice on the packaging here, the D has a 1 after it. This is because grade D has now been split into two subgrades, D1 and D2, the difference being that D1 is tamper-proof and may therefore be used in situations where tampering is likely. For new build domestic properties in the UK at the moment, grades D1 and D2 are the minimum requirement. Number three, understand your categories. However, confusingly, there's also the category of system to consider as well. This relates to how extensive the fire detection and alarm system is. This breaks down into two main categories, PD and LD. These relate to what the system is protecting. The P stands for property, and the L stands for life. These are then further subdivided into subcategories. These are LD1, which is the highest level of protection to include detectors in all circulation areas that form part of the escape routes, and in all of the rooms and areas where a fire could start, apart from ones with tiny chances of ignition, such as toilets, bathrooms, and the like. Category LD2 covers escape routes and high-risk areas such as kitchens and living rooms. Of course, to provide adequate protection and avoid false alarms, you'd use a heat detector in a kitchen so you don't set the alarm off when you carbonise your toast. And finally, category LD3 is the minimum level of protection, and this is your circulation areas that form escape routes like landings and hallways. One thing to think about in all of these categories is that if the loft is being used and contains electrical equipment, so if you have a lovely loft conversion or a new built room up there, then you should have a smoke alarm installed, as this should be considered part of an escape route. Or another situation may be that you have electrical equipment such as boilers, photovoltaic equipment, or uninterruptible power supplies in an unoccupied loft space. Suitable fire detection equipment should be installed in the space also, because of course a fire breaking out up there won't send smoke down to trigger an alarm until it's far too late to take action. Number four, supplies. There are a number of different ways to provide an electrical supply to the fire alarm. You can run a dedicated circuit in from the consumer unit to the smokes, as long as it's labelled as such at the consumer unit. However, it's also acceptable to connect the smoke alarms off a local, regularly used lighting circuit. This has the advantage that if the power to the circuit is lost, you'll know pretty quickly, as the lights won't work as well. It's best practice to keep the smokes on the same circuit as each other for a couple of reasons. One is that it makes safely isolating the smokes easy if they're fed off the same circuit, rather than having one on the upstairs lighting and one on the downstairs lighting. There's no room for ambiguity thinking that you've turned both off and one still being on. The other matter is that in a domestic situation, the sounder is usually integral to the detector, so that if one device is triggered, it communicates to the other detectors and sounds their alarms too. This is usually by means of a hardwired connection. Detectors are normally connected to each other via a three-core CPC cable, giving a line, a neutral, and kind of like a switched line conductor for the interconnection. Now you can imagine the harm that could develop by having a conductor connected between two separate circuits that occasionally went live when an alarm was triggered. It'd be worse than having a borrowed neutral. However, there is an exception to this rule, and that's if you're using one of these clever little devices like this one from Fire Angel. It's a smart RF radio module, and it allows the detectors to communicate with each other wirelessly. So you'll still need a main supply to each detector, but these could all be wired off of different circuits. Then you simply clip this module into the back of the detector and install as usual. Now, if a detector is triggered, the radio module will wirelessly send a message to the other detectors that are paired up in the property, and they'll all be sounded. It also allows for other options, such as remote reporting of the status of the alarm sounders via a Fire Angel Connect. Number 5, commissioning and certification. For many years, the smoke alarms were kind of neglected in electrical installation commissioning. Hopefully, the circuit got tested thoroughly, as any new circuit would, and a really conscientious Sparks would press the test button on the front to make sure it sounded. However, now it's important that the system is commissioned properly using appropriate triggering agents. So that's not smoke from a cigarette or from a match that you've just blown out, but rather using an aerosol smoke and a dispenser if it's required. Likewise, it's important to use the correct piece of kit to test the heat detectors, not just using a naked flame. And it's also really important to issue the correct certification. This would consist of an electrical installation certificate, as required by BS 7671 for the electrical installation side of the work, as you'd expect, but also a certificate for the design, installation, and commissioning of Grade C, Grade D, and Grade F systems. Just rolls off the tongue, the name of that one, doesn't it? This is a very simple certificate that contains key information about the client, the system, the installation, the installer, and by signing, it confirms that all the relevant testing has taken place as it should do. So there you go. Those are the 5 things to consider when installing fire detection and alarm systems, as demonstrated by the Fire Angel devices. And if you'd like to know more, we really do recommend having a look at the Practical Guide to Grade D Fire Alarm Systems book, and you'll find a link to that in the description below. But as always, we want to hear from you. Were you aware of all the requirements that we've considered in this video? What tips would you recommend to your fellow installers of smoke and heat alarms? As always, please leave your thoughts and questions in the comments section below, and all that remains in this video is to say thank you very much for watching.